Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is June 19, 2016. Today is Father's Day. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Telephone number is 937-323-7508.
Good morning.
Good morning,
and welcome to our worship service this morning, and happy Father's Day as we celebrate that day in our society this weekend. One note in regards to our worship today, the prayer of the day will not have any responses to it. It is just a straight prayer concerning Father's Day, so there will be no Lord in your mercy, hear our prayer. It will just be prayed straight through. Ask that you turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book for the order of confession and forgiveness as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship. As usual in Communion Sundays, everything is in your bulletin except the hymns. You'll need the hymnal for the hymns and also for the confession, which we do now. So I invite those who can stand without difficulty to please stand as we prepare ourselves with the order of confession. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. Let us now begin our worship with Rock of Ages, Pluck for Me, hymn number 623, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 623.
Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church. This is hymn is Rock of Ages, written in 1776. The author of the hymn was Augustus M. Topley. He was born in Farnham, England, and he gave his name to this hymn. His father died in a war, and he sang this hymn, Rock of Ages. He died at the age of 38.
Thank you.
Let us pray. O Lord God, we bring before you the cries of a sorrowing world. In your mercy, set us free from the chains that bind us and defend us from everything that is evil. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Seated.
Gina Pollock will be doing the readings.
From Isaiah. I was ready to be sought out by those who did not ask, to be found out by those who did not seek me. I said, here I am, here I am. To a nation that did not call on my name, I held out my hands all day long to a rebellious people, who walked in a way that is not good, following their own devices. A people who provoke me to my face continually, sacrificing in gardens and offering incense on bricks, who sit inside tombs and spend the night in secret places, who eat swine's flesh with broth of abominable things in their vessels, who say, keep to yourself, do not come near me, for I am too holy for you. These are a smoke in my nostrils, fire that burns all day long. See, it is written before me, I will not keep silence, but I will repay. I will indeed repay into their laps their iniquities and their ancestors' iniquities together, says the Lord. Because they offer incense on the mountains and revile me on their hills, I will measure into their laps full payments for their actions. Thus says the Lord. As the wine is found in clusters, and they say, do not destroy it, for there is a blessing in it. So I will do for my servant's sake, and not destroy them all. I will bring forth descendants from Jacob, and from Judah, inheritors of my mountains. And my chosen shall inherit it, and my servants shall settle there. The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
But now that faith has come, we are no longer subject to be a disciplinarian. For in Christ Jesus, you are all children of God through faith. As many of you as were baptized into Christ have clothed yourself with Christ. There is no longer Jew or Greek. There is no longer slave or free. There is no longer male or female. For all of you are one in Christ Jesus. And if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We're now singing Eucharistic Adoration as our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, is reading the gospel for today, the fifth Sunday after Pentecost, June 19, 2016.
Too much like Lexington. Okay, now I ask that you give your attention to the heart before.
Harvey Baker will give us special music.
Moving to Lexington, Kentucky. We're Dad would enroll at the University of Kentucky in order to earn his doctorate degree so that he could become a college professor. He loved to teach, and he knew that the only future he had in Jefferson County was, which happened to most successful principals, they kicked him up to the board after a couple of years, and they worked for the board no longer in the classroom, no longer interacting with students. So we spent 2 years in Lexington as Dad earned his doctorate degree. Today, if he had had that change of career, he could have stayed on the farm because the University of Louisville now offers that doctorate, but in 1964 they didn't. So here everything was uprooted, everything was in shatters. The girl, my seventh grade girlfriend and I, you know, sent letters to each other for a while, tears stained on them and all that, as we lamented being apart and how we wouldn't see each other probably again and all that you go through in the seventh grade. And so we moved to Lexington, had earned his doctorate degree. We moved back to Louisville, became a professor of education at the University of Louisville, and spent about a 20-year career as our longer because he semi-retired and continued to have teach courses and have students that he would guide even after his so-called retirement. At age 80, he finally walked away from the university completely. Well, as St. Paul has been writing this letter to the Galatians, he has been working up to drop a bombshell on the Judaizers. Now, you remember who the Judaizers are. These are so-called Christians who were Jews who supposedly converted to Christianity. But the problem with it is that they were saying that believing in Jesus Christ was not enough for salvation. That in order to be saved, you must also still abide by the Jewish law. Gentile men, in order to be a Christian, had to go through the rite of circumcision, they claimed. They said that the Gentile family had to abide by all the old Jewish festivals and rituals and traditions and commands. And of course, this put the church in Galatia in all kinds of turmoil. Because St. Paul, who had started the church, had told them salvation was by grace through faith, apart from works of the law. So now comes the bombshell. In verse 26 of our reading today, of that third chapter, St. Paul says these words that as you hear them and as you heard them read this morning and followed along, probably didn't seem that much of a deal to you or that big of a deal. But when I explain to you what's behind it, then you will understand why I say this was a bombshell that St. Paul drops on the Judaizers. In verse 26, he says, "For in Christ Jesus you are all children of God through faith." Okay, we're all children of God. We're the Judaizers. Would be stunned by this because in Jewish thought, in Jewish literature, only someone who was a child of God was someone who had or was very loyal to the law, who knew the Torah inside out and backwards, knew the Talmud, knew the prophets. And so the term children of God or child of God was not thrown around loosely. It was a title of honor only given to certain people. Yet here St. Paul now is saying, everyone who believes in Jesus Christ is a child of God. Everyone who believes in Jesus Christ are made up children of God, and they do not have to be circumcised. They do not have to abide by the law. They do not have to keep the Jewish traditions. They are a child of God simply through that faith in Jesus Christ. What St. Paul is telling us then is that as followers of Jesus, we rely solely on Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. The word through, when he says, "For in Christ Jesus you are all children of God through faith," that word through is a Greek word that literally means a channel of an action, a channel by which an action happens. It means then to rely on that action that has taken place. And eventually what it means, as St. Paul is using it, is to rely on Jesus. So the first lesson that St. Paul is telling channel of Jesus Christ. And by having faith in what Jesus Christ did, we are a child of God. By having faith in the idea that God, or not the idea, but the proclamation that God sent his only Son into the world to save the world through his death, resurrection, and ascension. By believing in that, you are a child of God. It's not by doing good works. Being a child of God does not come with a birthright. It does not come by a right simply being a human being on earth. It does not come about by good works. It comes about simply through faith. Through faith in Jesus Christ. Faith in Jesus Christ makes us members of God's family. And the wonderful thing is, no one can kick us out of that membership unless we do it ourselves. We get kicked out of the membership of the family of God only by stopping believing, or to stop believing in Jesus Christ, death, resurrection, and ascension as a payment of our sin, as giving us victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil, of giving us that grace which enables us to be saved by faith. And so the Judaizers will be totally stunned by what St. Paul said. And they'll have no argument for it. They can't argue. There's nothing they can come back with. We are a child of God because God wants us to be his child. God wants us to have a place in his kingdom. If God didn't, he would have made salvation a lot harder. And that's what puzzles me when I read about the religions of the world and how people, when they are following a world religion, and then here comes the gospel, and they turn their back on it, whether it's because of ethnic tradition or racial tradition or the tradition of their country, that the religion they're following has always been what everybody followed in their country. Because you read some of these religions of the world, and what they require of their followers in order to try to earn heaven gives you the impression that the deity they are worshiping don't want any of them to make it. Because it makes it so hard. There's so many rules, so many regulations, so many festivals you have to observe, so many traditions you have to observe, so many demands concerning what you eat and how you prepare it and where you, how you stand when you pray, and all kinds of monotonous demands. So you read that and it's like, wow. I don't know if I can do all that. But then here comes Jesus. Jesus says, come unto me, all you who are burdened and heavy laden. Burdened and heavy laden with sin and have no idea how that sin can be paid for or erased. Come unto me, all you who are heavy and are burdened and heavy laden with guilt because of what you've done. Come to me, all you who are heavy laden and burdened because you do not know how to have a relationship with God the Almighty. Come to me, for my burden is easy and my yoke is long. And how much lighter can a yoke be? How much easier can a burden be than believing in Jesus' death on the cross brings about your salvation? That Jesus' resurrection and ascension gives you victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil, and they can never have power over you again. As long as you are a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. As St. Paul is talking, he gives us two important images. First of all, he gives us the imagery of baptism. He says, for as many of you as were baptized into Christ, and then he says, have put on Christ. Now here the word baptized is not talking so much about the act of baptism or how we were baptized or what age we were baptized. It's talking more about what happens after baptism. That is, that you identify with Jesus Christ. You were buried, therefore, in baptism with him, so you are buried in a resurrection like his. You identify now with Jesus. You identify Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You identify with Jesus as your way of salvation. You identify with Jesus as the way that enables you to have that relationship with God. That you don't have to do anything. You can't improve on it. And so with that baptism, we identify with Jesus Christ. Then that word clothed. And those who are clothed in Christ, that means to put on a garment. It means to put on new clothes, or to sink down into a garment. It's imagery, of course, at the time of Jesus, agriculture is an agricultural meaning, and like you're working all day out in the field in a harvest. You're all hot, sweating, your clothes have gotten dirty, you're smelly, and you come in and you have an engagement that night, social engagement. So you bathe and you put on the new clothes. Well, when we identify with Christ, we put on new clothes, the righteousness of Jesus. That righteousness we can't have by ourselves. But when we believe in Jesus, we sink into that garment of righteousness, washed in the blood of the Lamb. So we have this new garment that no one can take from us, that makes us a child of God. So these are two important images that St. Paul uses to make it clear that we are members of God's kingdom, that we are children of God and members of the family. And so now, as members of the family, we do have a responsibility to carry on the family tradition. And that family tradition is to carry on the teachings of Jesus Christ and to carry on the instructions that Jesus gave us, not to try to earn salvation. We already have salvation. We do this as a response to that love that Christ has first shown us. We do it as a response to that love that He has given us. It's like I mentioned last week, we were talking about how Jesus accepts us and finds us and saves us. And use that imagery of parents and a child, the poor child. Like, the child was born. It's not really conscious as far as we know of mother and who the mom and dad are, but they know them by smell and touch and so forth. Once they get older, they respond to that love of the parents. When they're newborn babies, they only respond by crying because they're hungry or wet or tired or whatever. But as they grow older, they respond to parents, to the mother, to the father, with words like, I love you, or you're special, or some other words of affection. And as they grow, they continue to do that. That's a response to the love that you as a mother or father first showed that child. Well, that's what we're doing with Jesus. He first loved us, so we're responding to that love. So we are children of God through faith, not by anything that we do. Then the second important lesson that St. Paul is telling us today is we are one with all the children. Remember Sunday school, vacation Bible school? One of the very first songs you learned after Jesus Loves Me was Jesus Loves the Little Children of the World. All the children of the world, red and yellow, black and white, we are all precious in His sight. Unfortunately, the history of the church hasn't always shown that, at least in America. We have had problems with sometimes ignoring those who are different. Yet St. Paul tells us there is neither Jew nor Greek, there is neither slave nor free, there is no male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, then you are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to promise. So, among the children of God, we are not to use tags to identify. We're not supposed to promote or deny due to race, creed, color, gender, ethnic origin, whatever. But we are all one and all to be treated as one. And all welcome as one. There was a cowboy who moved off his farm, his ranch, as he got older and turned it over to his son and decided he would move into town. And so he got him a nice little place in town, and right down the street within walking distance was a church. So he walks into church the first Sunday morning with his cowboy hat on and his cowboy shirt and his faded jeans and his cowboy boots. this guy wandering off a TV movie lot or TV lot, show lot. And so the preacher preached and the service ended, and as he left, no one said a word to him until he came to the pastor, and the pastor shook his hand. He said, sir, I said, I want you to do something for me this week. And the cowboy said, okay, what can I do for you, pastor? He says, I want you to pray to God and ask him if he thinks your dress is appropriate for worshiping him in this house. So the cowboy was kind of taken back by that. He said, okay, I'll pray to God this week. So the next Sunday show turns up. Cowboy comes in dressed the exact same way. Same hat, same shirt, same faded jeans, same boots. Again, nobody says hi to him, nobody welcomes him, nobody tries to help him. During the service, when he was having a little trouble figuring out the worship book, and when it was over again, nobody said thanks for worshiping here, said nothing. Pastor comes to the pastor shook his head. Excuse me, he said, but didn't I ask you to pray to God and ask him if what you're wearing was appropriate to worship him in this house? And the cowboy said, yes, sir. And he said, I did pray to God. And I asked him if what I was wearing was appropriate. And the pastor said, well, what did he tell you? The cowboy paused for a minute and looked at the pastor. He said, well, pastor, what he told me was, I don't know what you wear in that church. I've never gotten that. See, that's what happens when we fail to remember that we're all children of God, not Jew or Greek, not slave or free, not male or female, but all one in Christ Jesus. That is why we have a lot of downtown churches that are becoming smaller and smaller, because their history was they were founded by a certain ethnic group, or they were founded by a certain group from a certain country. And the belief was always that the boats would just keep coming. But then, after World War II, after the 50s, the boats stopped coming. There were no more Scandinavians and Germans coming over. There were no more Scots or Irish or English or Welsh coming over to fill up the old downtown Presbyterian churches. There were no English and others from the United Kingdom to fill up the Episcopal churches. And so downtown churches have now struggled as their neighborhoods have changed and the makeup of churches have changed. You go out to suburban churches and it's different. Because in suburbia, people were used to driving to church, and when a new church was formed in suburbia, it wasn't formed by any ethnic group. It was usually formed by a national church planning a mission there, and a pastor would be sent as a mission developer, and he would just grab anybody he could get. He wasn't concerned if you were German or Scandinavian or Polish or Hungarian or Austrian or Russian. All he cared about was getting enough people in the church so that they could form and organize and receive support from the national church until they got on their own feet. In the suburbs, they realized that we're all children of God. It didn't matter where we were from. Downtown churches, unfortunately, too often had history to them that was locked into a certain ethnic group. And so people moved out and moved away. A couple of years after the war between the states, a freed slave who had started a cobbler business, shoe repair business we call it today, in Richmond, and was beginning to have some success. So one Sunday morning he came into a fashionable church in downtown Richmond to worship. Well, nobody really noticed him until it came time for communion. As he walked down the aisle and he knelt at the communion rail, you could hear all kinds of mutterings and grumbling in the congregation, words of shock, words of anger that this former slave was kneeling there at their communion room. And then suddenly, after an awkward pause, one of the laymen in that church got up and walked down the aisle by that freed slave. With seeing that, the rest of the congregation came up and knelt below the communion rail. The lady who set the example for the others, reminding them that there's not Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male or female, was none other than General Robert E. Lee, the leader of the Army of Northern Virginia, the Confederate forces in the East, who had not been a slave owner, and who but had fought for the Confederacy because of Virginia seceding his own state. But he on that Sunday remembered these words of St. Paul, that we're all children of God no matter what we look like. We're all children of God no matter what our politics are. We're all children of God no matter what our socioeconomic status is. We're all children of God no matter how much education we have or haven't had. We're all children of God no matter where our families are from or what their background is. We're all children of God because we believe in Jesus Christ. We're all children of God because we believe that Jesus Christ truly died on that cross to pay the debt, my debt, your debt, everyone's debt, for the sins that we committed. So we should celebrate whenever someone new comes into the community of faith. We should rejoice whenever a child of God joins with us in worship. And we should rejoice each and every day over the fact that we truly are the children of God. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Help us to resist the urge to stay stuck in past bitterness. instead moving forward with humility and peace of heart. We ask the further blessing on those men who served as father figures in our lives when our biological fathers weren't able to do so. May the love and selflessness they showed us and return to them in all our relationships, and help them to know that their influence has changed us for the better. Give new and future fathers the guidelines they need to raise the happy and holy children, grounded in love for God and other people. And remind them, the fathers, that they are treating their wives with dignity, compassion, and respect is one of the greatest gifts they can give their children. We pray that our fathers who have passed into the next life have been welcomed into your loving embrace, and that our family will one day be returned in your heavenly kingdom. We ask your generous blessings today and every day. Amen. May it be.
Watching our service, St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, as the acolyte is bringing forth the offering plate, and the ushers are coming forward to gather the offering. Today is Father's Day. We're honoring all fathers. We're also honoring the fact that we're children of God. Our sermon is that we are children of God through Jesus Christ's death on the cross, forgiving us of our sins, and our Christians. We'll be singing the last hymn today. Will be "Just As I Am Without One Plea." And this will show that we are accepted by God no matter what we are. He accepts us as his child. All we have to do is ask, and nobody can take that away. Only we can withdraw from being a child of God. This is St. John's Lutheran Church. We invite you to come, to invite Jesus into your heart, to make him a personal savior, to come to a Bible-based church, to help take care of the people who are in need. Today, our flowers are given by members of church here. We're taken out to the people in the homes. They're given by Jeannie and Ann Denny and Debbie and Mike Cochran in memory of Glenn Cochran's birthday. His birthday is on Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all of you who are out there. We have our service at the drive-in. We invite you to come at 8 o'clock every Sunday, rain or shine, or come to the Sunday school at 9:30. Parable Sunday school class still happening in Sunday school. Or you can come to the 10:30 service, which is what you're watching now. God asks us to worship him, to receive him as our personal savior, and he gives us his body and blood. We will receive his body and blood when we believe in the real presence. As Jesus said, "This is my blood, this is my body given for you."
Let us pray. Holy God, gracious and merciful, you bring forth the food from the earth and nourish your whole creation. Turn our hearts toward those who hunger in any way, that all may know your care. And prepare us now for the feast on the bread of life. Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body will literally be present as we gather at his table in our communion age and our own individual congregation. You're invited and encouraged to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of the Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 6 in your worship book. The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts,
we lift them to the Lord.
Let us give glorious resurrection, open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and a host of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Oh,
your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Grant that we who have received the sacrament of his body and blood may abide in him, and he in us, that we may be filled with the power of his endless life, now and forever.
Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
We conclude our celebration with Just As I Am Without One Plea, hymn number 592, in the back of your red worship book. Hymn number 592.
Was written by Charlotte Elliott. She wrote, in England, her father was an Anglican, her brother was an Anglican clergyman. She never felt that she rated Christ's blessing. She felt inferior, and then she became a Christian, and she sang Just As I Am, and she realized that Jesus took her just as she was. She's a child of God. We celebrate Father's Day today, and we also celebrate that we are children of God, both. Those things today. Happy Father's Day. Just as I am, just as we all are, without one plea. Charlotte Elliott said, June the 19th, 2016, 50th Sunday after Pentecost. This is the most beloved hymn in history of the church for invitation that we will be accepted just as we are. Come and worship anytime with us at St. John's Lutheran Church, just as we are. St. John's Lutheran Church at corner of Wittenberg and Columbia. We are on St. John's YouTube. So just click up on Google and get us on YouTube and watch our service. Tune in any Sunday. We offer a Christian school program for ages 3 and 4. We're building a new playground. We have nursery and pre-K. We thank you for joining us in our worship today. Thank you for joining us on Father's Day, as we have our earthly Father and we have our heavenly Father. We're celebrating both today. We want to bless you and keep you all your days. We will pray for you. Continue to pray for us and support our YouTube ministry. We're at the corner of Wittenberg, Columbia. We enjoy you to come anytime.